Hello everybody and welcome to video number 14 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. You might remember that we started in the last video with chapter 3, parameter limits for fusion plasmas, and this is where we will continue this time. So we will first outline the general principle how to analyze the stability. And what we do is we analyze stability limits by applying the so-called energy principle. So we will analyzing the stability limits by applying the energy principle. I will explain that in a minute. So we have stability limits and energy principle. What does that mean? So at first we will take an equilibrium and perturb that or deform it. So we will deform an equilibrium by a small perturbation, and we use the letter psi for that. Probably the one which is the hardest to write, and this is definitely wrong. This is better. And second, we will then calculate the change in potential energy due to that deformation. So the second step is to calculate the change in potential energy due to that perturbation. Now let's try to illustrate that a little bit. So let's assume we have a situation like this, where we have here our potential energy with a capital U of x, then here spatial coordinate x, and then we have potential like this, and then inside of the potential we have our starting position here. And now when we move that into negative x direction or positive x direction, we are moving upwards this potential wall, meaning the potential energy changes and it's getting larger. And this means we have a stable equilibrium. Now, if on the other hand side, it looks as follows, again, spatial coordinate x, our potential, and now the spatial distribution of the potential might look like this. And if we have our initial situation sitting here on top, and then perturbing this one, so we would move into a negative x direction, going downwards into this direction, positive perturbation into this direction, then the change in potential energy is negative, and this is an unstable situation. And a change in potential energy which is negative means the kinetic energy increases, so it is a conversion of potential energy to kinetic energy, corresponding to an unstable situation. Now, what do we take as equilibrium? Since we have here a magnetic confinement situation, we take the flux surfaces as equilibrium. So we take the flux surfaces as equilibrium surfaces, which we perturb. Then what we do is we expand the perturbation or the deformation into modes to make life a bit easier. So we expand the deformation or perturbation into modes. And what do I mean by that? Let's quickly draw our equilibrium situation. So it might look, for example, like this supposed to be a poloidal cross section. Now let's copy that a few times since we need a few examples. And then like this. And if we now we can perturb it multiple ways. I said we want to expand the deformation or perturbation into modes. And modes are characterized by mode numbers, and an M equals one perturbation would mean just shifting the whole flux surface. So this would be an M, this would correspond to an M equals one perturbation. So this M is here the poloidal mode number, since we're having a poloidal cross section. This is a poloidal mode, or corresponding to a poloidal mode number. An M equals two perturbation would look, for example, like this. So we have a twofold symmetry, basically, of the perturbation. So roughly, right? I guess you get the idea. So this would be an M equals two perturbation. M equals three perturbation would correspond to something like this, roughly. This would be an M equals three perturbation. So you get the idea of that. Now, let's assume we have a linear tokamak, so a screw pinch, meaning the geometry would be something like, well, we have, if this would be our tokamak expanded into this direction. Oops. Expanded into this direction. Then we would here have the length of 2 pi capital R naught. Linear tokamak. Sorry for this kind of very tight space here. This direction here, so going from here into this direction, this is the Z direction. Then we would have, let's try to draw this, this small r. So this one is small r. And then we need an angle. This is the one, sorry, which goes down here. And this is the angle theta. And then we can Fourier decompose all modes as such that the perturbation psi, being a function of r, theta, and z, can be written as the sum over the mode numbers m and n. And we have an amplitude term, mn, being a function of r, and then the exponential, which has in the argument I times m times theta plus n times z over r naught. So a Fourier decomposition of the modes. Something very handy and very useful because it allows to make the calculation of the actual equilibrium and the perturbation of that and the resulting change in the magnetic energy much easier. So what you need to do then is you need to analyze the change in potential energy delta U for each mode separately, for each mode. And as I said, it's you have an unstable situation if the change in potential energy is negative. And when you do that, you find that the most unstable modes occur if the mode numbers are resonant with the flux surfaces. So the most unstable modes occur if the mode numbers, Mn, are resonant with the flux surfaces. So where the modes appear, yeah? So the most unstable modes occur if the mode numbers where these modes appear are resonant with the flux surfaces. And this means that M, or being resonant with the flux surface, means that M over N, so the mode numbers, are equal to the safety factor, or that the inverse of that N over M is equal to iota bar. And as an expression how to properly say that, so if you have a deformation of if you have a deformation which is unstable against mode numbers M and N, you call that an unstable, and then you use brackets M, comma N mode. So this is meant by saying you have an unstable MN mode. And what I have written here basically is equivalent to say that QS, so the ratio of M over N, if you have an unstable mode there, that this has to be rational for the most unstable modes. So this is a very general property, very general finding, that if the mode numbers, the ratio of the mode numbers is equal to the safety factor being a rational number, then you find the most unstable modes. And remember, the safety factor is not constant, it is a function of the radius. It means along its profile, along its function of the radius, you certainly have positions where you have a rational number for QS, and thus these are prone to instabilities of a certain mode number combination. Okay, a few words on how to characterize unstable modes. So the characterization of unstable modes. So first of all, we can distinguish between different driving mechanisms. So first of all, we have the drive, and this is, well, it is always some kind of gradient, but there are two types of gradient in the plasma. One is the pressure, so these are then pressure-driven modes, or, of course, this is mostly a tokamak topic, current-driven modes. Because only in a tokamak we have the large currents. And then current-driven modes can be further distinguished or categorized. So current-driven modes can be further distinguished, and what we can say about them is that they depend on the resistivity. And first of all, we have so-called ideal modes. So we have ideal modes to start with. And ideal modes means that we have no resistivity. Or, well, perfect conductivity. Which means basically we have an ideal MHD situation. And that means that the flux surfaces are only deformed. So flux surfaces are only deformed. They are not broken apart. Remember from maybe plasma physics one lecture that in such situations the magnetic field is frozen in the plasma. So an ideal MHD. Now, we can have ideal modes, but we can also have resistive modes. And You might be surprised by that, but resistive modes mean that the resistivity is finite now. You might have guessed that probably. And this means that, that reconnection is possible. That reconnection of the magnetic field lines, reconnection of field lines is possible. That means magnetic islands can be formed. That allows for magnetic island formation. Now, what happens during magnetic field line reconnection? Maybe just a few words on that. So if we have the following situation, so to start with, we have two field lines, for example, one field line going like that, and then another field line going like that. So they are close, but separated. Then there is a strong plasma flow from the top, let's say, pushing downwards. Then there is another plasma flow here pushing upwards. So U1, U2. So we have a situation where the field lines do not interact with each other. Due to the strong plasma flow, they are pushed together, such that the situation might be, for example, now like this. So they are very close to each other. So the we have an area here where they are very close. And if this continues, if we have finite resistivity, then reconnection can finally happen. And then the field lines will look in this example, this one will go like this. And here we will have one going like this. So the field lines are basically reorganized here. And magnetic energy here is converted into kinetic energy. So this is a process thought to be responsible for acceleration of cosmic particles, for example. So if we think about MHD phenomena in space, so this is a very interesting topic and still a subject of very active research. So this is about reconnection here. About resistivity and reconnection. And then there is a third current-driven mode, which we will not talk about in the lecture, but we definitely should mention it here. And these are wall modes. And here the resistivity of the vacuum vessel wall plays a role. So here the resistivity of the vacuum vessel wall is taken into account. And what happens here is that currents can be induced in the metal vessel wall, and this can affect plasma dynamics. So currents induced in the metal can affect the plasma dynamics. And you can, for example, if you think of a metal wall, of an ideal wall with a negligible resistivity being very close to the plasma, then the currents induced in that wall can actually help to stabilize growing modes inside the plasma due to mirror currents being induced in the wall. This is something which is researched in the reversed field pitch in powder, for example, or also in medicine, and a very interesting concept. For burn effusion plasma, however, you might have the problem that the walls cannot be so close to the plasma, but it's definitely these are definitely very interesting experiments to study the effect of such modes and how to stabilize modes and something, and we can learn definitely something from these experiments for ITER. Okay, so that's it basically for this lecture, but I think I should maybe make a very brief reminder on ideal MHD, since I said that a few times, just that we are all on the same page here. So feel free to skip that last slide. Well, I guess, I mean, feel free to skip anyway the whole lecture, but I would be more happy if you don't do so, but of course, feel free to do so. Just a brief reminder about ideal MHD. So in ideal MHD, we have a few initial assumptions. So, A, we assume that the characteristic time scales we are looking at, those are larger than the ion cyclotron frequency, or, well, the inverse of that, or the time scale given by the ion cyclotron frequency, meaning that tau, typical time scale, is larger than the inverse of the ion cyclotron frequency. Then B, that typical length scales are much larger than the ion gyro radii, than the ion gyro radius, meaning that L for a typical length scale, much larger than the ion Lama radius, rho Li. Then C, we assume to have a collisional plasma, which means we have a Maxwellian distribution. And this basically means that the length scales are much larger than the mean free path, so the average distance between two collisions. And then D, that we have no dissipation. Meaning that the viscosity is basically zero. Now, applying these assumptions allows us to make a few simplifications during calculations. And a few remarks on ideal MHD, because ideal MHD is something very useful. So, for example, the ideal instabilities which we find within this, within these assumptions, within these limitations, are generally the most fastest and most violent modes. So it's definitely already very important to know just these modes. So the so-called ideal instabilities or modes, so modes or instabilities described within ideal MHD, they are generally the most fastest and violent modes. And if we have an ideally unstable plasma, such a plasma won't last long. So we definitely have to take care that the plasma, well, to start with, is ideally stable. Now, in addition, the non-ideal instabilities are often just some variations of the ideal instabilities. So there are, of course, a few exceptions, but often the non-ideal instabilities, those are often just some variations of ideal instabilities. And then finally, ideal MHD works generally in hot and collisionless plasmas, so fusion relevant plasmas. Ideal MHD works, and this means holds, can be used, can be applied in hot, and hot often means that basically it's a collision-less plasma, in hot plasmas, if the typical perpendicular length scale, because this is what is important in a magnetic confinement experiment, is larger than the ion Lama radius, yeah? So the perpendicular length scale. Okay, finally, that's it for this video, where we talked about the general stability, or the general way how we analyze stability limits, namely by applying the energy principle. We talked about that we expand the deformation or perturbation into modes, that we Fourier decompose them, and I told you that the most unstable modes occur if the mode numbers Mn, being the poloidal and toroidal mode number, are equal to the safety factor being a rational number. Yeah, so these are then the most unstable modes. Then we can characterize or distinguish the unstable modes usually into how they are driven. So either pressure driven or current driven. And then the current driven modes can be further distinguished or separated into ideal modes, where we do not have resistivity, so this is ideal MHD. Then resistive modes, where we have resistivity, which means reconnection is possible. And then wall modes. And finally, I gave here an overview about or reminder about ideal MHD. Okay, that's it for this video. Hope to see you in the next video.